we have heard in our own circles, in our own way of life, various interpretations, such as the Aquarian Age, and we might even say into the terms of the more fundamentalist, such things as the approaching millennium, the second coming, and so on and so forth. There is also at this time considerable confusion, which is naturally evident in times of a great change or a metamorphosis which is taking place among the races and peoples of the world. It is a very necessary part of such evolution. It means that such people are becoming more or less stratified or reaching certain plateaus or elevations in their own personal interpretations of these values of life. Now I feel sure that every one of us here have considerable and a justifiable sense of pride for being American citizens. We pride ourselves that we have a greater understanding of life in this country, a greater interpretation, and a higher elevation of living. It is reasonably accurate to suppose that this country is also, if the human race is to evolve into a future dimension or time, where such relative factors as the proper integration of spiritual consciousness does take place in the hearts and minds of people, that America will be at least foremost in the ranks and the leadership of such movements. It can also be assumed that America was created from some of the more divine concepts from the higher dimensions of life. There are grave dangers which are very apparent to the peoples of the world at this time. It is my purpose, if I can, to go into some of the more basic problems in the relative plane of introspection and to see if we cannot interpret some of these things for you. As individuals in this coming change or great evolution or cycle in consciousness of mankind, there must always be those who are the way showers, to those who go ahead. It is they who perhaps take considerable of the brunt, the burden of the critical attitudes of the multitudes of the world. They are the inventors, they are the scientists, and there are other and various and sundry interpreters of different concepts of life. Getting into some of the basic and more specific problems of mankind as he exists upon the planet Earth today, that it is quite obvious to the layman or student of truth that we are indeed living in perilous times. Since the explosion of the atomic bombs over Japan in 1945, and while they brought a sudden and dramatic close to World War II, man has become increasingly aware of the fact that these were very perilous times. It has also become quite obvious that with the coming of this new atomic age, and with the many hundreds of thousands of new electronic, chemical, and mechanical inventions, there have been great changes in our daily lives. The new methods, a means of communication and transportation, have shrunk our planet down to a very small size indeed. We no longer have the natural protective barriers of oceans and mountain ranges and vast distances. We are constantly being reminded of the fact that enemy bombers can fly over our country and reduce it in a very few hours to a pile of atomic ashes. These are facts and compounded by great numbers and multiplicities of the numerous scientific discoveries and inventions have all given rise to new vague fears, problems, compromises, and pressures, and consequently more distortions in the average individual's life. Further conflicts are added when such an individual tries to free himself or to solve these conflicts. Unless he is fortunate to have a completely objective mind, he may only find himself mired more deeply in these quicksands of the countless concepts, expressions, and derelictions which he is surrounded with. Moreover, the average individual does not have a completely objective mind. It is a well-known fact that the average individual cannot think constructively from the subjective mind, or this mind is merely the screen whereupon all the countless acts and experiences of his life are reflected. What he calls thinking is merely objective relationship of present tense to any one of a number of such previous experiences and reacts according to such extractions of comparisons. Man's patterns of life are made even more confusing and complex by the realization of certain spiritual elements of life. These he may vaguely realize internally or externally. They may take on various vagaries of spirits, gods, angels, demons, devils, ogres, etc., or they may be merely superstitions. He may also be impelled by some inward desire, wherein he seems to feel an affinity with some great creative force or forces, which may or may not be inspirational, wherein he may feel some sense of relief from the pressures around him. Now, individually, each man's problems are different. He also looks upon life differently and interprets values according to his own concepts. Yet, basically, the elements which can solve every man's problems are the same. That one or several of these elements are missing in the average individual's interpretation of life is quite evident. Collectively, as a community, nation, or all nations, our position in life is a direct byproduct of the great masses of people. It is also apparent that while man interprets life in an infinite number of ways, yet man is collectively the same person. In our analyses and introspection, whereby we must arrive at a basic platform of evaluation, whereby we will solve not only for ourselves this riddle of life, but assist substantially in solving the same riddle for the masses. How then can we attain this solution? It may appear first that it is a strange paradox that man has at the present time, just as he always had, this solution in his hand. Looking back into the written pages of history, we see the rise and fall of nations, empires, and peoples, all with the same basic problems, the same internal and external strife, to orientate themselves into what they believe the best way of life. This is at present, just as in past times, every individual's own interpretation of self-realization. The great collective masses of the world are torn between the values of material elements of this realization and the more vague inward desires of the higher self. And so it is that of today we see mankind in this same life and death struggle, with these internal and external impulsions and repulsions. On one hand, he has been brought up in a society of social structures which place great emphasis on self. Therefore, he develops a strong ego. This ego, or selfhood, is something which is composed of all the ingredients of reactionary thinking which the individual thinks necessary to support his life. Here again is conflict. For he sees about him in the varied ways of a society a necessary amount of integration and a dependency upon his fellow man. He is constantly forced to admit to his fellow man as much like himself, with the same basic problems, relationships, and with the comparable amount or lack of intelligence. This strong material ego may also complicate a person's life, inasmuch as with certain deflations of this false ego structure, give rise to various emotional conflicts, which develop a neurosis or a neurotic thought pattern. A further search in our analyses reveals much factionalism and a great deal of dependency upon these various scientific, religious, or political factions. These various factions also add confusion to the individual or to the masses of people, for in such dependency in these factional relationships always lead the individual astray. Such dependency is a form of a moral opiate, inasmuch as the person does not now face his problems realistically and solve them for himself. It should be apparent that as the moral fiber of the nation is composed of masses of people, we can therefore resolve its strength into individual structures. That if a person is weak, inadequate to solve his own problems, he becomes one more of those proverbial links in the chain, the weak links. There are also other factors in the expression of these various factions of which everyone is quite aware, and that there is much hypocrisy, self-attainment for wealth and power, exploitation of the masses for suffering. To bring our introspection down to a definite point of focus, it is quite evident that the world is drastically in need of a new philosophy, a new hope, a new sense of direction. It is also quite apparent that such new philosophy will not come from any existing structures, neither religious, scientific, political, or otherwise. Neither will it come from individual leadership. If Jesus appeared in person today, it is quite likely he would go unrecognized. John Q. Public has built up a strong resistance to all existing types of salesmanship, spiritual or material. Or even if he was recognized and established, it would immediately create and recreate the same reaction was demonstrated in Palestine. Various minority groups would, who wield some sort of power, are very jealous of their positions. So are various and sundry religious factions and their leaders. So it would only be a repetition of his previous life. Somehow, in some way, there would be another crucifixion. We can imagine the trouble Jesus might have if he was here today and practicing without a medical license. What would the AMA say? This might also be true as to form and pattern of any other avatar who might reappear. Buddha's mission, like Jesus, did not materialize until more than 200 years after his death. By that time, serious distortions and malformations had taken place in the originally simple, straightforward philosophy. Zoroaster and his work suffered a similar fate. Only Muhammad was more fortunate, for under his direction the Quran was written and Islam established, which has withstood most of the attempts to reinterpret or distort its concepts. So it can be said that of the vast welter of religious and interpretations either in the East or the West, and that while they all contain much truth, inspiration, and virtue, yet it is evident that man will not, for various reasons, try to readapt or reestablish a new concept or philosophy of life from these existing structures, which would reunite man in his numerous factional expressions into a universal brotherhood, which would heal the world of its ills. It has been truly spoken that love is the great directive force of God, and agreed by men of all nations, races, and creeds, that if we to love each other would unite man in a common brotherhood.